last night, if you slept, and I very much hope that you did, when you went into dream sleep, you became flagrantly psychotic. And in fact, you did that several times throughout the night during those REM cycles. Now, before you reject my diagnosis of your nighttime psychosis, let me give you five good reasons. Because first, last night when you started dreaming, you began to see things which were not there. So you were hallucinating. Second, you believed things that couldn't possibly be true. So you were delusional. Third, you became confused about time, place, and person. So you're suffering from disorientation. Fourth, you had wildly fluctuating emotions, something that psychiatrists call being affectively labile. And then how wonderful, you woke up this morning and you forgot most, if not all, of that dream experience. So you're suffering from amnesia. If you were to experience any one of those five symptoms while you're awake, you would be seeking perhaps psychological or psychiatric intervention. But yet, for reasons that we're only now just starting to understand, this seems to be both a normal physiological and psychological process each and every night. REM sleep and the associated conscious experience that we have during REM sleep that we all call dreaming really is a case of how your brain goes completely out of its mind. Dream sleep, or REM sleep, is brain activity that seems to be almost indistinguishable from that when we're awake. With the advent of more powerful MRI scanning technology, we've been able to look deep within the brain itself. And during these studies, we have people go inside of a scanner and we have them fall asleep. And when they go into REM sleep, we turn on the scanner and we can start to look at the changes in their brain activity. In fact, some parts of your brain are up to 30% more active when you go into REM sleep than when you are awake. And firstly, what we found is that regions at the back of the brain that are associated with visual processing, what we call your visual cortex, those areas burst into life. There's also motor areas of the brain that control movement and this sort of sense of kinesthetic movement activity. Those light up in their activity. But there is another brain area that does something in the complete opposite direction, and particularly the left and the right side of your prefrontal cortex. Now, you can think of your prefrontal cortex a little bit like the CEO of your brain. It's very good at making high-level, top-down, rational judgments, logical decisions, and it also helps control our emotional impulses. But this part of the brain, when we shift over into REM sleep, goes in the opposite direction of all of those other areas. It is actually switched off or deactivated during REM sleep. So how does this help us understand the dream state? We see visual areas lighting up, motor command areas lighting up, memory and emotion areas lighting up, but we see logical, rational, reasoning areas being switched off. That sounds very much like a brain science description of a dream. Dreams are visual. They're filled with motor activity. We tend to be doing things. Are they filled with past autobiographical memories? Yes, very often. Are dreams sometimes emotional? They can be very much so. Are dreams irrational, illogical, bizarre? Yes, very much. And so brain science has given us the first neural evidence for describing the way in which we experience this strangest of all things called the dreaming state. Some strange things happen to our perception of time as we sleep. So at one level, we lose all sense of time. Think about the last time you got on a flight and you fell asleep. And when you wake up, one of the first things that you will typically do is look at your wristwatch or try to check the time. Why? Because you don't trust your own perception of time when you sleep. You don't quite know how long you've been asleep. So in some ways, at one level, time can actually be lost entirely. But at another level, time can be distorted. And often we will have what we call time dilation. And this usually happens when we dream. So, for example, let's say that you use an alarm clock and you have a snooze button, and you are woken up right in the middle of a dream. And then you hit your snooze button, which is for 5 minutes or 2 minutes. And then you go back into the dream. And then you are dreaming in this vivid, narrative, long way. And you think, my goodness, this snooze button goes off and it was just 2 minutes later, but it feels as though you were dreaming for 15 minutes, 20 minutes, maybe even an hour. So it seems as though during dream sleep, time gets stretched out. So it's this dilation of time. Why would that be? Well, looking at rats as they are replaying different experiences that they've learned during the day, we found that that replay of those experiences speeds up during non-REM sleep, but it may actually slow down during rapid eye movement sleep. And perhaps it's that slowing down of time that creates this perception or this distortion perception that 2 minutes in the dream world feels like 10 minutes in the real world. One of the other features of dream sleep or REM sleep is the fact that as your brainwave activity starts to become much faster and very similar to waking brain activity, there's something else that happens to your body. In fact, your brain will paralyze your body so that the mind can dream safely during REM sleep. So all of us are actually locked in a physical incarceration within our own bodies when we go into REM sleep. And it's this protective mechanism. From an evolutionary standpoint, you could well imagine that if you are dreaming and you think that you can fly and that you can sort of lean out your window and jump out, if you actually were enacting that behavior in reality, you would be popped out of the gene pool very quickly. And Mother Nature has found a way to prevent this from happening. So the brain, and particularly the brain stem, sends a signal down the spinal cord and it paralyzes all of the voluntary muscles in your body. Now, that doesn't mean that you stop breathing. They are the involuntary muscles. So your heart keeps beating and your lungs keep respiring, but all of the voluntary muscles, the muscles that you control yourself to move your arms and your legs and your mouth, all of those undergo this paralysis of REM sleep to prevent you acting out your dreams. The origin of dreams, or the belief of where dreams come from, has a very storied history and past. Back in ancient Roman and Greek times, they believed that our dreams were being gifted to us from on high, from in the heavens, from specific gods. And they named their gods, they named some of them after these different sleep and even dream-related gods, such as Hypnos and Somnos, Morpheus. And then other cultures, for example, Eastern Asian cultures, believed that dreams were coming from somewhere in our soul, perhaps somewhere in our body. And it took us through until the 1900s and a gentleman called Sigmund Freud, who finally brought dreams into the realm of the brain. He made, in some ways, the science of dreaming a brain science, a neuroscience, because it was Freud who suggested that it was somewhere in the mind of each of us that our dreams were coming from. That was the repository of dreaming. Now, Freud did a remarkable service in bringing the purview of dream and dream study and dream science into the brain itself. But after that, things really took a turn for the worst. Freud, in some ways, was 50% right and 100% wrong. He was 50% right to think of dreams coming from the brain, but then he developed a theory called disguised censorship, which believed that dreams were repressed wishes that sat somewhere in the mind. And if they just came out in their raw form, they would be so shocking and surprising to the dreamer that they would wake the dreamer up, for example. And so instead, our real motivations and our desires had to be disguised. And in some ways, they were sort of pushed through a filter, what he thought of as a sensor. That sensor would disguise the dream. And when it came out on the other side, that was the thing that we experienced as the dream. And then Freud believed that he understood how that dream encryption worked, and he had the code. And he could reverse engineer the dream that you told him, and he could sort of pull it back through the filter, decrypt the dream, interpret the dream for you, and therefore, at some cost that he would charge you, he would tell you what your latent, suppressed, manifest wishes and true desires actually were. Now, the problem with Freud's theory that he published in a book called The Interpretation of Dreams, and the theory was called The Disguised Censorship Theory of Dreaming, is that it's not a scientifically testable theory. It doesn't set forward a specific proposal, a specific hypothesis, and it doesn't lay out a specific set of predictions that you can test. And if you can not test a set of predictions, then you are never able to either falsify or prove that scientific theory. And in some ways, this was both Freud's brilliance and his simultaneous downfall. We could never, by that token, disprove or falsify Freud's theory, and that's the reason that he sticks around today and we still speak about him. But also, why science abandoned Freud, because we could never prove his theory. Now, I'm not suggesting that talking about your dreams or recording your dreams or investigating your dreams isn't meaningful or important. I think it actually can be. I think there's certainly something about our dreaming life that is reflective of our waking life. And if anything, it seems to be that our dreaming life is a reflection of our emotional concerns and our emotional anxieties. So if there's one red thread that runs like a strong narrative from our waking life into our dreaming life, it does seem to be our emotional concerns. But to argue that Freud's theory is a scientific theory and holds scientific weight, unfortunately, just isn't true. And that's why we've sort of abandoned some of the Freudian psychoanalytic notions. That common phrase, if it's not one thing, it's your mother, doesn't seem to hold weight.